Yeah. Okay, so this has to do with the secularism point, am I right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Particularly with the French, so like the
National Cathedral and that. Yeah. Well, I had more of the French in mind in France when I said that, because they have this long tradition of enlightenment. And it was because of this that the philosophy of religion distinguished itself from theology in the West. Because in theology, you believe. In philosophy, you question beliefs. Okay? So the scientific, modern scientific view is basically that religion is false. So that is why I said that the extreme secular position would be, as I stated. But let me use this opportunity to clarify the point further, in the sense, and I must confess I skipped over this, that in the three kinds of secularism, you can have what is called negative, what may be called negative secularism, and then we may have what we could call neutral secularism, and then we can have what we might like to call positive secularism. And the difference then would be that the attitude the state had towards religion in the former communist countries would provide an example of negative secularism. They were secular in the sense that the state did not have religion. This is the minimal definition of secularism. The state does not have religion. But they promoted atheism and were even hostile to it. So that would be an example of negative secularism. For neutral secularism, you just have to go across the border. The famous First Amendment says that the Congress shall make no law regarding the establishment of a religion or preventing the free exercise thereof. Completely balanced out. So you have neutral secularism. And of course, the USA has the largest percentage of churchgoers among all the industrialized countries in the world. Positive secularism then would be the kind of secularism I think we are struggling to achieve in India. Because the Indian understanding of secularism really is pluralism. Now, there is a very interesting difference between pluralism and secularism. Let me first begin, however, not with the difference, but with the similarity. Both of them aim at the same thing, preventing the public square from being dominated by the majority religion or culture. This is the common goal of both the secularists and the pluralists. The difference is in what they would like to replace it. The example could be, if you argued for a holiday on Sunday on business grounds, that would be a secular argument. But if you argued for a holiday on Sunday because Christians should be allowed to go to church, and on Friday because Muslims should be attending afternoon prayer, or for the Sabbath, and that would be a pluralist argument. The pluralist position accords a place to religions in the public square without preferring one over the other. And the basic instinct in secularism and the basic drive of the concept is to keep religion a purely private matter. I hope that clarifies the issues. This is the hinterland of politics, we'll never emerge from that. Let me address the first one, it's directly relevant to what has been said. I think what you are saying is basically true, and many scholars in the field have made the same point. However, students of religion especially like to refine this point a little further. And in philosophy of religion, it is now customary to distinguish between three positions, or rather among three positions. What is called exclusivism, and what is called inclusivism, and what is called pluralism. Now, it is very important to keep in mind that what is crucial here is, and the basis of differentiation of these positions is, the soteriology of the system, meaning who is going to be saved. That is the focus. If you say that only followers of my religion are going to be saved, then you are an exclusivist. If you say that although ultimately you have to come to my position to be saved, but your position is morally and spiritually beneficial and helpful and brings you closer to our position ultimately, and then you will be saved, this is inclusive. And pluralism is that you are okay, I am okay. Right? Yeah. Now if we look at the religions from this point of view, then we may have to concede that the positions of, okay, there's a problem here because these religious traditions like Christianity and Islam have a long history, many manifestations over different parts of the world. So if you take a synoptic view of this, then you might say that all three positions have surfaced in the course of their history, somewhere or the other. But when you come to the main nine positions, probably you can cogently argue that for long periods of time, in many parts of the world, in certain parts of the world, the position of these religions, that is Christianity and Islam, was not so much exclusivistic as inclusivistic. So the harsh distinction between yes and no, the binary distinction which you were trying to draw, has to allow for this idea of gray in between, which is conceded by these traditions freely. They have concepts for them. There's a concept of Ahl al-Kitab, people with a book, yeah, in the Quran. There are concepts of the anonymous Christian in Christian thought. So, while broadly acceptable, the kind of generalization you made, when we use that generalization to imply that therefore these religions have to be prone to a certain kind of behavior.
And that was not my intent.
Yeah. And then we have to introduce this element of sophistication in the history of thought. Position one, that you should bring them up in your own tradition, but also expose them to other religions, as they recommended. And then, of course, once they come of age, they make their own choice. But again, to give it some thickness in terms of the Gandhian treatment of it, you might remember that scene in the film Gandhi, which is based on a real life incident, in which after the Calcutta riots, a Hindu comes to Gandhi and says that they took my son and smashed him against the wall. And what do you expect me to do? And Gandhi says, I'll tell you what to do. Select an orphan of the age of your son. But make sure that he's a Muslim. And bring him up as a Muslim. Because his religion is Muslim. When Gandhi was in London, a person by the name of, I only remember his last name, Bradlaugh, who was a very famous atheist of his time, died. And Gandhi attended his funeral out of admiration for his commitment to the cause. So for Gandhi, heroism was more important than either theism or atheism. With what vigor and dedication do you pursue your God? That was his truth for Gandhi. And this brings in all the discussion you have had about the Western concept of religion itself, and so on. My response would actually be, in some sense, Gandhian, would be that people should be free to promote their religion, but not to proselytize. See, when you proselytize, you select and target individuals or groups for conversion. You induce them, you give them inducements, you intimidate them by saying that you will go to hell if you don't become a Christian. Right? You offer them inducements that will give free education to your children if you become a Christian, and so on. You mislead them by saying that your religion is false, in terms of Gandhian view of things. So no recourse should be taken to these kinds of things. And because, according to Gandhi, what he saw being done in the name of proselytization was precisely this, that is why he was going to ban it. Elsewhere he says very clearly that all religions should be free to propagate their ideas. If that was not to happen, then how would we have the various scriptures, you know, and our knowledge of those scriptures, how it reaches, and so on. So it's really, in modern terms, it boils down to the question of the ethics of conversion, not conversion per se. The basic approach would be the same to both kinds of conversion. That they should be resolved non-violently, that people should be free to follow their own understanding of their religion, that you should not use unethical means to try to bring them to your own understanding, and you should make a careful study of their position.
Formulation that God is truth, to the later formulation that truth is God, and some authors have written that this was a move to be very inclusive, including inclusive of atheists who could not believe in a theistic deity, but who may have a deep commitment to truth. And the formulation that truth is God for Gandhi is a theological, if you like, formulation which is broad enough to provide a very big tent. Could you comment on that?
Yeah, I think this is quite true. And in fact, when you make this, what we call metathetical inversion, of God is truth into truth is God, he actually writes, denial of God we have known, denial of truth, we are not. Mm-hmm. So this is a more encompassing formulation. Mm-hmm. And given his attitude towards atheism and all that, he said probably more true to his position. Mm-hmm.